So if you have, you are in a web-based business, you've got to have, distinguished web domains. It's better to have a distinguished web domain. So, you know, again, we'll have questions, and I'll be happy to take questions along with my friend Kapil.
Thank you, Kapil, and thank you, Jatin. And both of them have touched upon areas which would be of concern, which I'm sure will have some questions from most of you on those areas. But a few things which crossed my mind while I was listening to both my co-panelists call. For instance, for startups, there are a lot of issues when you start a business. Your focus is what you want to achieve. Your focus is on deploying capital in whatever limited measure you have, or if you're lucky, in surplus. Your endeavor is also to eliminate all risk factors involved. Risk involved factors can be as varied as business threats, can be as varied as HR-related issues, employee retention, issues like that. Therefore, first and foremost, I have just a few comments before we open this up for Q&A. I certainly feel that you're the best person, whether you're an entrepreneur or whether you're a group of people who are starting out on a business. You are the right people to prioritize what you think is essential for your success. Whether elimination of risk comes as number one, whether spending, deploying maximum capital comes as number one, whether innovation comes as number one, you have to identify what is a priority for you when you start a business out. The minute you identify the priority, that's when you need to know the legal do's and don'ts. What do you do and what you don't do? I think law is not beyond all of us. It's very much a part of our day-to-day living. We all know how to assert our rights. We all know how to seek enforcement because we're well aware, we're educated, and so on and so forth. But I think where a lawyer or where a law firm or where a consultant come into place is to give that finesse to your understanding, to make that understanding enforceable and acceptable. And that is exactly where you need to go to lawyers. Otherwise, for startups, personally speaking, I've had reasonable experience over the last 10 years advising startups in India. And I always feel that law seems to be a very scary big thing. The idea is, of course, that law should put some fear in you. You should have some sort of respect for it. You should not take it for granted. But it also doesn't mean that you should feel overburdened, that any business has to be sort of mired in legalities, that you have to have everything legally sound. You will discover, you're a startup, you will stumble and you'll get up and you'll walk again. And the minute you start to walk, you have to realize where you went wrong. And that's exactly where legal knowledge is essential. That is where you start realizing what the law can do. And this applies a lot, especially when you're looking at starting out in businesses which are, as both Jatin and Kapil mentioned, which are IPR sensitive. That's just one aspect of it. That IPR is something where you work hard, you set up a business, you put in your sweat, and suddenly you've got five employees, out of which one is a guy who's not sort of honest. And he cheats you by taking away your ideas and starting it up in his own fashion. And that is something which is extremely demotivating, is damaging, it affects the business. And at the end of the day, for a startup, it sort of discourages him to have trust in people, which is a very negative connotation. You can't do a business without people. You can't even run a tuck shop by yourself. You need employees. Therefore, issues like this have to have certain legal safeguards. And that's exactly where the idea of bringing in contracts, NDAs, so on and so forth comes in. So my first reaction is prioritize what you want to do in business. Once you prioritize, then start on the legal course. As I said, whether you're going to be investing for the first 2 years, or you're going to be investing in knowledge, or you're going to be developing a product, whatever you're doing, prioritize it, follow it up with a legal thing, and then automatically you start appreciating what the law can do. Because you realize that what you're doing is being protected. And the only protection, which is the biggest issue for any business, is protection. You're out on your own. You might get registered with ROCs. You might get registered with other regulatory bodies or statutory authorities. But at the end of the day, the whole idea of getting these covers is protection, to enforce a right, to be recognized in law as somebody. Therefore, it is very important that when you start up on a business, you should have basic information. Basic information, if I may put it, is, as Kapil was mentioning, starting out in a company format or if it's a partnership, then it's a slightly different way to go about it. But if you're in a company, you're starting out in a company, then you have to have compliance issues, which, contrary to what we all do by sound, it's very, you can do it on your own. In this day and age, information is a click away. You can do it on your own. You need a backing of a professional only at certain stages. So my suggestion for all startups is devote time to knowing what the law is, because the law is the only safeguard you have. Therefore, please don't take it for granted that it's only when you end up in trouble will you approach a lawyer. Inform yourself. Inform yourself from the minute you decide what you want to do and how you want to do it. That's one issue. The second thing is that the mechanism of law is very interesting. It not only tells you what your rights are, it also tells you how to enforce those rights. So for instance, if you have an IPR issue, you know the best way to go about it is to file a civil suit for passing off or infringing depending on the nature of the IPR you have, and seek remedy through court. Do realize you're a startup, therefore funds are limited, resources are even more limited. Therefore, if you can avoid that step, try to do as much as you can to go to that stage, which is putting in processes in place. If you started a business, an MBA is a very good idea to have in place to make sure that your employees have a certain degree of discipline at work and there is some constant supervision. At the end of the day, thefts take place because people don't pay attention to the people who are working below them. They take them for granted. Therefore, what kind of processes can you employ? I have an experience with a very young startup started by people who were 18, 19, 20 here in Sector 34. And they were doing excellent stuff, including for clients like the US Homeland Security. I mean, they were into ID cards and biometrics. I'm talking about 2001. I was amazed to see when I went to their office, probably a room half the size of this room. And there were three security guards. There were three security guards of private security, not armed. Probably they couldn't even figure out what was happening. Obviously, because you've got IT people working in what would a basic security guard whose qualification is a non-IT background, with a non-IT background to be able to do. But the idea of deterrence definitely worked. So, for instance, those three security guards standing in three corners or sitting on a chair in one corner and four teams of three, four people working in one room, to a certain extent, worked as a deterrent, but admittedly it wasn't the only way to save what was being developed. However, innovative ideas always need protection. Therefore, maybe this is a very crude form of showing discipline to enforce security, but it was also to make the employees right, sort of realize that you're under a watchful eye. CCTV cameras is another way. All these things seem expensive in terms of investment, but sometimes they help. They help, and if you can afford them, maybe not use such cruder forms, but try to model it in a way where all this is protectable on paper, and you have contracts for everything, you're calling out assignments to teams to do, you must have undertakings, you are hiring people. There is a concept which all of us hear of is indemnity bonds. See if it works, if it doesn't. At the end of the day, going to court in India is probably the easiest thing to do. The most difficult thing is to come back from court. You've lost it. You've lost it the minute you started. So, I mean, my suggestion always has been that yes, you feel that you have a right, you feel you have a law which protects you, and at the end of the day, that law is going to be enforced by a court. Therefore, we end up in court. What comes worst comes to worst, I hire a big fat lawyer who will do very well, and I'm sure he'll defend my rights better than the guys who stole it. But why leave those things to chance? Startup is something which you know is basic. You buy a bicycle, you buy a lock with it. It's as simple. You don't buy a bicycle and just leave it outside. Similarly, you start a business, you have to prioritize what is the focus of this business. Innovation is the focus of this business. If you're an IT concern with innovation, then how do you protect innovation? Just sit down and think yourself. As I said, lawyers and law firms always add that fine touch to it. I mean, they give the polish to the law surgeon. But at the end of the day, the realization has to come from you. Maybe when you're as big as Narayan Murthy and Infosys, you can hire a full team of 600 lawyers for all Infosys work all across the world, wherever you want to do. But God willing, you'll reach that stage one day. But before reaching that stage, you must inform yourself. I have had the pleasure of interacting with people in Indian corporate who are heading companies as big as Infosys. And I assure you, they know what law is. They might not know what happened yesterday in court, and they might not know what happened 3 months back, but they certainly know what their rights are. They certainly know what copyright issues are. They certainly know what sort of mechanisms have to be in place to ensure that there is a certain degree of protection given to a startup. That's one concern. Therefore, in conclusion, don't think that going to court is the resolving of an issue. It's, from my experience, it's the beginning of the most complicated issue you can have. I mean, running between lawyers, supplying information, it's not one of the easiest things. And it's extremely frustrating because you have no control. Where you have no control is where you get frustrated. Where you have control, you can exercise, you might try and fail, but you always have room to improvise and do things. In a court system, you have no improvisation. Your destiny is in somebody else's hand. So as a startup, please take your legal rights very seriously. Please inform yourself in whatever field of work you're doing, whether you're a service-based startup or an IT startup or something else. Inform yourself what are basic protections. That's one. That's the second thing. And the last thing is costing. At the end of the day, every business has to figure in or factor in an element of cost. Lawyers, unfortunately, have a bad reputation of taking away all hard-earned money the startups make, but that's not true. Look at it as an investment. Lawyers charge for their expertise, just like you start charge for your own. Going to a lawyer should not be a deterrent. Going to a lawyer should be an investment. And therefore, you must factor in a component in your budgeting that, yes, legal costs come in. After all, at the end of the day, if you're a company which is incorporated, you have statutory requirements of going for auditing, for accounts-related services. You provide for that. Similarly, legal costs, especially for young companies, should be a factor in. If you don't use it in 1 year, it piles up for the next year. If you don't use it in the next, then it piles up for the third. But budget for that, because it will help you feel not only more confident that you have the wherewithal to withstand a legal issue if it comes up, but more importantly, it gives a very professional structure to your organization. You're taking your business seriously if you provided for it. Again, the example of the bicycle. You buy a bicycle, you have a lock, you have some security. Therefore, legal issues have to be taken. Please don't lose yourself in your ambition of being big by overlooking such basic necessities. You are a young generation. You're moving with the times. Imagine yourself, thanks to internet and information access, that you're at par with any global startup, whether it's been done in the Silicon Valley or whether it's been done in Mohali. You're at par. You're no way less. You might look at material things to differentiate that infrastructure is there in California and it's not here. That's all meaningless. What's important is ideas. For startups, it's ideas which matter. And if ideas are the basis for any startups, then please put them under what blockchain, gold, whatever you can. Having said that, I'm going to open this up for questions. I would appreciate if you can just introduce yourself before you ask questions. Please.
My name is Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Gagan Uriel. Back from the US after 11 years. I have a company in the US. Just a few questions here. You mentioned that foreign nationals can
be directors.
So, do I need an Indian partner or
Indian citizen? Both the directors can be foreign nationals. There is no problem on that.
But do I need two directors for
a company? Needs two directors. One of them can be a foreign national. Or one can be a foreign national. The only thing is you need to have 10 and correct the digital signatures in place before you go to the registry.
Okay. You were mentioning everything can be done online. Do you suggest I use my US company or should I register another company here?
Depends. If you want to open a branch office, license office, or you want to start a new entity, your Delhi or your Chandigarh company can be a wholly owned subsidiary of the US company. Again, it depends upon the scope of work. How you want to do it. It all depends on your business model.
You were talking about like copyrights and so I have an ID company and I have a real estate portal. So for the real estate portal, just any copyright and logo or for the URL or for the code?
Kagan, just a small request. You're most welcome to put your personal question related to your business once you're done away with this, because you'll appreciate that some people might not be as interested. Please don't mind this. My idea is to just have it open to general queries which might be of interest to other members who are sitting or other people.
Yeah,
but please,
sure.
Yes. Yes. Can I pass the mic to you?
Would
you? I can leave it to both the panelists and then I can address myself. Why don't you take this
first?
It depends upon the law firm and the lawyer. What is their basic charge? We do work on retailership basis, we do work on value basis, and we do work on assignment basis. So whatever models fit you the best, you can choose that. Supposing if you think that you require minimum 20 hours a month, so we can come out to a conclusion that if you use minimum 20 hours, so we'll charge you this much. If you just need to register your company or you just need to register a trademark, we'll give you a free quote for that particular assignment. So I guess for a startup, it is good to have a free quote for a particular assignment in place, because in your start module, I don't think so, you'll have the issue that where you need to retain a lawyer. So for a trademark, you can take a quote for a trademark since it takes 3 years. So 90% of the lawyers charge on face-to-face basis. They'll charge you a minimum sum, the filings, and at the arguments, and at the objection levels. So you have to pay that particular sum within the span of 3 years. That is how we follow. Maybe some other law firms have a different model for it.
I think that's the new one.
I think how it works is, especially for the agreements, you know your business the best. So what I recommend is provide, go on a project, you know, go on a case-to-case basis. Go up with prepared, you know, prepared scope of work. This is what I want. These are my challenges. These are my risks. These are my threats. These are the opportunities. This is what I fear in the worst case scenario. Put that down in paper, and you know, take it to the lawyer for review. That will save you a lot of costs. Personally speaking, if somebody comes to me with a prepared set of ideas, steps, it makes my job much more, you know, a lot easier. So I charge less, and you know, it works best for both. You know, I don't know if it works best, but ultimately it works best in the interest of the client. That the client knows his risks. I know what his risks are, and then ultimately the work product is better and it's cheaper. That's one. About the trademarks, the copyrights, and the basically the intellectual property. That's a tricky thing. You need to discuss each and every aspect. A lot of times, a lot of good, not just good, great ideas have come while sitting on the table with a client. You know, you tend to think a lot more, and once a person sitting on the other side is just somebody who's been dealing in ideas all the time, or who's got that background exposure of what's going on in the world, there tend to be a lot many other things that come to the table that you do not think of. You should never be your own lawyer in that sense, right? Go and talk to reason out, and then you'll get much better ideas. Never run away from, you know, bad things, because, you know, just don't keep them on the side. Because when you go and ultimately go up in the real world, you'll probably face all those. So, you know, work on it a lot and then consult.
And just address that briefly, in addition to what the couple just mentioned, there are different cost patterns. I mean, lawyers charge, as any other service professional does, and they charge for their time. You should be the one who should be able to decide which one you go to. And just like you got service professionals of varied kinds, lawyers also are of varied kinds. Just like you got IT companies of various kinds, so on. So if you have the basic thumb rule clear that my requirement is met by Mr. X, there is no harm going in for a very open way of asking what arrangement do you have. Because sometimes the professional himself can determine what your need is. I can give you personal experiences where I've had companies from the city come in very enthusiastically, initially engage us for a long term, and then because of various factors, I had to reevaluate that relationship. It is always helpful to have a more open relationship with a professional, because at the end of the day, a lawyer is somebody whom you need only in a certain situation. So therefore, you should appreciate if you share more with him, he's able to give you a better opinion in terms of costs, in terms of how long will it take, and so on. There are no set patterns if that is what you're looking at. There are no set formula, there are no set guidelines by the parent bodies would say that a lawyer has to charge this much, a law firm has to charge this much. It's a variable cost. I hope that addresses your issue. Great. Yes, please.
I would like to add first question. As a startup, we are actually doing a lot of things. We are planning the idea, we are executing it, and then there's the legal part, which we don't have anything in our hands, or we don't know anything about that. We even don't know like what data I need to collect to give it to my CA to file the return at the end of the year. So I believe the question was to have a person besides you or work with you on a monthly basis or daily basis to have the idea like what kind of things we need to do to be secure or to have that lock.
Okay. Two things. I think I get your drift. If you're not you're obviously a non-legal person, therefore you have issues which you can't address yourself and you need help. Yes, services like this are available very much in the city. I again know of companies who outsource elements like this. I mean, outsource is a more popular term to identify with. So you don't use your office space for doing this kind of work. you use the office space of somebody else whom you engage on either a monthly basis or a yearly basis, depending on what your budget constraints are or how liberal you are. And that person, I know, in the case of one particular company, or in fact more than one, is even issuing checks. For instance, he's an accountant, he's a chartered accountant who's taken on this company. He's providing a turnkey solution for something like 25 to 30,000 rupees a month. Starting from bookkeeping, which means all your vouchers, receipts, salary maintenance, payroll, everything, plus issuing day-to-day checks. So, I mean, if you can afford that, I think it's an ideal model. Why? It lets you focus on your core area of competence, which is what you do best. And that, I think it's a minor cost at the end of the year. Imagine the time saving, imagine the HR cost you're saving, imagine the administrative cost you're saving. You're not wasting stationery, you're not making, I mean, wasting paper. Issues like that, if they're outsourced, I think it's a very innovative way of doing well for a startup. Areas you're not comfortable with, you can always outsource. And as I said, I know of companies in this region, in the country, and more locally, who started doing this. So professionals are also aware of the needs which new young startups have. So if you look a little more deeply, you share it with your service provider, your chartered accountant or your lawyer, I'm sure you can set up an arrangement. I'm sure. Please.
I'd like to add here, you said you don't know anything about accounts, etc., etc. As a startup, you've got to know about that. It's a very, very important part of growing, learning. Because if you don't know about it,